Hello. So we're going to be looking at types, and we're also going to be looking at traits. We're going to be looking at how you have chapter 10.2. So we're going to be looking at how you have an impl as instead of a concrete type for the item parameter, we specify the impl keyword and the trait name. What I've done is on top of that, I've researched and kind of got ChatGPT to help me. And I've got this example where not only have you got the impl, which constrains the type, but also it needs to implement type T, where T is standard format debug. It's got to implement iterator and it's got to implement standard format debug. So quite often you'll see impl with the trait name. But here we're adding an additional type constraint. So this is a type constraint, and that's kind of the why I called the video type constraints. So we start off with a generic function signature. So print, excuse me, print iter is a generic function that takes a parameter iter. So that's my name that I've given it. Of type impl, iterator. And there we go, where item equals t, and that's the kind of the type constraint part. So the constraint trait bound, where t is of type standard format debug. So it doesn't have to be standard format; it could be standard format display, well, and it could be any trait you want. But this constrains the type t to types that implement the debug trait, allowing formatted output for the debugging. I thought what I'd also do here is just kind of this is not a live stream, but if it was a live stream, yeah, I just want to kind of just make sh try and start to use the correct terminology. I've probably been guilty in the past of saying argument when I should have said parameter, or yeah, I've said variable when I should have said type. So making a very conscious effort to try and be very correct with terminology because I think that's important. And that's probably the difference between someone who's learning and someone who's, advanced or senior. And after all, we all want to be senior because. Right, so let's I could type this in. Could try and type it in and remember it from memory. I've got a gist of this code, so let's I can remember this line. Let's go with the signature then. So I'm just going to come back here, and this was me. So follow a week later after doing my video on using closures and functions, I just came back in here today just to check that I can still remember it. I think I left a comment in the community saying how I treat learning code a bit like trying to learn a piece of music. So obviously you look at the sheet music while you're learning it, but eventually you want to be able to just know it. So I might do this at the end of the video just if anyone's interested, but yeah, I can just about remember how to use closures and functions, which a week ago I couldn't, or 2 weeks ago I couldn't. Right, so I've also started typing at the start what I'm actually trying to do. Because I think if you don't get it clear in your head what you're trying to do, then well, you get halfway through writing the code and then you realize, yeah, you weren't actually coding what you thought you what you were meaning. So this will be using, that's big enough, I'll make it one thing bigger. Using type constraints. Feel free to watch this on 1/2 speed or 1.25 speed. My typing's not the quickest. Using type constraints with impl in functions. I hope that's kind of a good starter. So let's just put in a main function just to keep it happy. And then I've actually forgotten what I called the function. What did I call it? Oh, print So print underscore iter. I had a really good comment saying that the difference between kind of an experienced coder and someone who's not is also the variable names and function names. Just be descriptive. Don't try and make them short, because even if you think you yourself will remember them, you may not. So, so we've got input, and that is constrained by impl, and then that was iterator trait, where item equals, and that you have to use item, and then that's t, because you want it to be generic. And do I need t at the start? I think I do. And it's just okay, that's reasonably happy then. It compiles. Right. I think I showed in the previous video, just for kind of, because I spend a lot, probably most of my time just doing tutorials and learning and doing mini projects. There we go. One, control W, I've set up a Vim key binding, allow unused. Probably won't, this will probably not work now because I've put in the, there we go. It's got rid of the warning messages. So yeah, just control W, I've set up as a key binding in Vim, which just puts allow unused, and it gets rid of all the warnings when I'm printing. So, okay. So we're going to need where here. So we need to say what T does. So this is actually quite similar. It's kind of one of the reasons why I wanted to do it, because this is quite similar syntax to using closures and functions. Standard formats debug. Okay, so then we can just use it. I'm just going to format this as well. So I've got another shortcut, backslash, which is leader, cf. I don't think it... I kind of indent these as well. Right, for I in iter. Sorry, for I in input. So whatever you've called your... input variable name is what you'll use here, and then just and I think that's it. And I've done that without looking at the my GitHub gist too much, so I'm reasonably happy with that. So let's do right. So it's going to need an iterator pass to it. So let's make a vec. My underscore vec. In the I know I keep banging on about it, but it's so good. The Rust in the Month of Lunches book. Yeah. My underscore vec. I was just being lazy when I started, and I was just calling it MV or my V, but I don't know. Call it what you want. Vec. And what I'm going to do is show you how this is because the function signature or the function is generic, we will be able to use this function with I32, and then we'll use F64 or whatever just to demonstrate it. So start with, I'll make a vector 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then so if we just try to do print iter, we'll get an error if we pass my vec to it. And we'll look at the error message because it'll be quite interesting. The trait iterator is not implemented for vec iter. So into dot into iter, we need to do dot into iter on my vec when we use it here. Dot into iter will that will pass by value. Think, correct me if I'm wrong. And there we go, that's fine. So let's now do another vec, but we'll do what we've just done here. We'll call it my vec. I'll turn off type hints. My vec 2, and we'll just make these F60, F64, F32, doesn't really matter. Just a different type, just for the purposes of proving that this is generic. Okay, and we need to just pass my vec 2 into the second example. I could shadow the variable, but it's for demonstration, it's just a bit clearer this way. There we go. So we've got a generic function which is using type constraints. So the type constraint is this bit. T, where item T is a type that it can implement the standard format debug trait. So I'm trying to look at what I would call medium level or difficult examples. And then again, start with the book, because somebody's spent a year of their life researching and checking this, and this has been proofread. Then I go to ChatGPT, or I would go to Rust Docs. In fact, the Rust Docs, I don't think they really go into detail too much on type constraints. Let's just check. Type constraints. Not really. Appendix B, appendix. Then the first one that's not appendix is this, which is the good old point example. Yeah, so we end up back at chapter 10. So this kind of introduces you to using impl as passing into a function. But what I've done here is kind of that, but it's adding in the type constraint. Let's just continue to read the ChatGPT explanation, because as far as I know, and please feel free to comment on this, but as far as I know, this explanation kind of makes perfect sense, and I think it's correct. I'd be interested if anybody can. I have called it out a couple of times recently. I think when you know that you're improving with Rust or anything, you start to ask ChatGPT questions, and then it replies with "You're correct," or "I apologize." So I think that's a really good measure of what the level you're at. And it's quite inspiring, because as time goes by, you find yourself asking it more questions and find it catching it out. So, but for this purpose, I think I can still learn a lot from it, because it does use the correct terminology, and I think that's important. So the function body iterates over the item I in the iterator, and it prints the println macro with the format specifier, which relies on the debug trait, which is the whole point of using T and this bit here. So the main function, and yeah, that's kind of, they did i32, 16. Okay, vectors, we know how to do that. So summary, that's what we want. Print iter function is a generic type constrained function that prints each item of an iterator provided the items implement the debug trait. I think that's fine, that's correct. I'm happy with that if everyone watching is. So let's just run over it one more time. So we've created a function, and we've passed in an input, which basically it needs to be compatible I'm kind of paraphrasing and using sort of more basic language. So it needs to be compatible with iterator traits, and it also needs to be able to use the standard format debug trait. So there we go. That's quite good. I think if you learn this, I'm happy to share the gist, the GitHub gist of this. But I mean, it's on the screen now if you just want to. I think also when I first started trying to kind of seriously learn Python and Rust, I was still getting in bad habits where I was copy and pasting far too often. And yeah, you definitely need to actually be typing it, because it's just, if you copy and paste, you'll just not memorize certain things.